Freddie's okay, which is awesome. Thanks for being so cool and just taking some time and letting things settle. And everything is okay. So I'm gonna go ahead and get started on the piece. Everybody grab their tactile objects.
Yes.
You can take like those whole big trays if you want. There's so much water, please take them. Do you remember? Do you remember with your bones or your teeth or your skin or your hair? I remember. There's a darkness I feel in my bones. It's dark blue gray, and it doesn't encompass me, but it is my scaffolding. It's the material from which the frame of my spirit is built. It is not mine. I can feel my frame, my insides. And it is built from that dark blue-gray scaffolding of my ancestors. You can see some of it in my eyes. When my sister was little, she told me that my eyes were green but also bluish gray. And looked uncontrollable, like the sea. Sat my snorkeling goggles. I remember singing this. wanted that there was so much more of it than there was of me. Thank you. The second to last night my grandmother was alive, and the last night I spent with her, I had driven in from Minnesota and arrived in the evening. It was late, and she was tired. She wasn't speaking at this point. Her body had slowly broken down to Parkinson's disease, and she was lying in the medical bed that had been brought to her bedroom in her home. My sister, my parents, and one of my brothers were there. My brother made a joke about her staying up late, waiting up for us to party. We smiled at her and laughed a little, and very slowly she arched her eyebrow and a mischievous look spread across her face. We all laughed a lot harder, a little bit in disbelief, but also in joy. Her communication had deteriorated, and it became difficult to understand her speech. So it was such a sweet gift to see her make a joke. After that, my sister and I, side by side, rubbed her hands with lotion until she fell asleep. My sister on her right and me on her left. That was the last time she would be awake. The last weeks of her life were a parade of friends and family. People came to her home to see her and say goodbye. Old friends from her time working at the high school, friends from the neighborhood long ago when my dad and aunts were little, friends whose names I've been hearing all my life, all arriving to visit, all keeping it sweet, an unspoken send-off. As I sat across from my sister, rubbing my grandmother's hands and sending her into her last sleep, I looked down and I was startled. For the first time, I realized that my hands were her hands. They looked just alike. I couldn't believe that I hadn't noticed before. The same childlike simplicity, the same sturdiness and strength. They also looked unaged. They were so recognizable as my own. These hands that had helped raise me, that had cared for me and my brothers and my sister and my cousins. These hands that were me. The nails made the same round shapes. We soothed her to sleep, two sisters, and two sisters before us, my aunts, and my grandma and her sister, and my great-grandma and her sister, and Bertine and Ester. Thank you. I walk down my Chicago block, and I feel the stillness of the late November air. When everything is dying, the approaching prickle of the frozen atmosphere on my skin. I'm always a little too cold in the winter. A little too chilled everywhere I go. My hands somehow always icy. My feet coldly insulated in my thick socks and boots. As a kid, I remember standing on the bus stop in the winter, looking down at my shoes and shivering, waiting. I could feel the wind gnaw up around my wrists, grabbing at my legs hungrily, exploiting any gaps of air I could find. I remember feeling alone. I wondered if everyone else felt the cold the same way I did, felt it rip through their bodies, pick at their skin.
Now it's up to the judges. Amen.
My purple running shoes pound into the paved trail. This is the part where I edge closer to the lake. I spent much of the pandemic running around and around the lake near my house as the clouds reflected the lake, reflected the clouds, churning through the ways my heart was changing. Glistening and reflective, or gray and rolling, I circled it over and over again. Over and over again. I circled it over and over again. Over and over again. I circled it. As the clouds reflected the lake, reflected the clouds. I circled it over and over again. I I circled it over and over again. Churning through the ways my heart was changing. I circled it over and over again. I circled it over and over again. I circled it over and over again. I circled it over.
Denne sang tilegnet de to tapre små piker på Flatholmen fyr, som efter en heltemodig kamp for å redde sin far og sine to brødre, kun fikk reddet den ene bror, mens faren, fyrvokteren og den andre bror druknet.
Thank you.
Pull the air in with your nose. Fill up the whole balloon in your chest, but in your belly too. Hold it just for a moment. Let it go, let it all go. Push all the air out of the balloon until it is totally flat and empty, void of air. Through your nose, fill up the balloon. Up, 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 up. Hold. Release, let it all go. Push the last bit of air out of the balloon. I brought my breath so I can stop thinking about the air hunger. So I can stop sucking in air over and over again, never quite getting enough. There were times maybe I thought there was something wrong. Maybe my lungs weren't working. Maybe a hidden heart condition. I would read about pulmonary disease, read about the cardiovascular system on the internet. It was anxiety. I started reading about breath, started routing and rerouting. Trying to catch the right timing, the right feeling, so that I could deepen my breath and stop feeling so hungry for air. To catch a full, deep breath and feel satisfied, I started recognizing that the hunger was caused by the feeling of reaching. Filled up, the heavy feeling in my chest that would start to happen while I lived in my head. Until I learned to drop low. Settle back down, touching against my diaphragm, to settle back into my body, instead of trying to fill up and float away, trying to take me away from whatever I was scared of, like caged, ballooned wings. From inside a brightly lit suburban store, we emerge into the dark, windy night in a still, cold springtime. As it hit me, the smell and feel of the air overcame my body. I felt the urge to sob bloom in my chest and up into my throat. Caught off guard and confused, the feeling hit with such intensity as the tears glazed my eyes. "We got some good stuff," my mom says cheerfully, looking for the car. "We did," I say as I nestle my face deeper into my knit scarf, wiping the corners of my eyes, squeezing my coat tighter around me in an effort to tamp down the feeling, smelling the wind. Please fill out the feedback form. I'd love to know what you thought and what I can do next time. So thanks again for coming.